guys, we are weaving quickly through 1 Peter. I think about 3 weeks here we can get through these last two chapters, maybe 4 weeks. We are going to look at 1 Peter 4 tonight, verses 1 down to verse number 6. Appreciate your patience with us. And then we're going to dive into 2 Peter, and it's going to be really fast as we make our way through the spring and want to be done before summertime hits. But I appreciate your patience with me. I know Brother Mark Haverly talked a couple weeks ago while I was gone, and then last week we had an opportunity to hear some stories about Mardi Gras, and I hope that was good for you. I know a couple of you have said you might be interested in going next year. That'd be great. We need a group of about 12. 12 is about a perfect number. It allows you to take two vehicles and to maybe do some rotating shifts, but it also is a good number for cost reasons, you know. You can get too many, and the cost don't get met, so you have to raise the price of the trip. But we'd love to have another six folks go next year and make that happen. So I want you to be praying about that, okay? Also excited about India. Looks like we're going to have a nice-sized group go to that. If you want to go to India and you haven't signed up yet, you need to talk to me fast, because that's going to start rolling quickly. It's only 10 months away, 10 months away. So 1 Peter chapter 4 tonight, verses 1 down to verse number 6, Peter writes, "Since therefore Christ suffered in the flesh," he says, "arm yourselves with the same way of thinking. For whoever has suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin, so as to live for the rest of the time in the flesh, no longer for human passions, but for the will of God. For the time is past, suffices for doing what the Gentiles want to do, living in sensuality, passions, drunkenness, orgies, drinking parties, and lawless idolatry. With respect to this, they are surprised when you do not join them in the same flood of debauchery, and they malign you." That sounds familiar, doesn't it? "But they will give account to him who is ready to judge the living and the dead, for this is why the gospel was preached, even to those who are dead, that though judged in the flesh the way people are, they might live in the spirit the way that God does." In verse number 1 here, Paul writes, "Since therefore Christ suffered in the flesh, arm yourselves with the same way of thinking. For whoever has suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin." You know, Peter, up to this point, has been discussing how we're supposed to model the character of Christ, right? All the way through, from beginning to end, it's about living out the gospel. It's about how it is that we model the person of Jesus, specifically in the midst of difficult times, in the midst of difficult suffering, in the midst of when we don't understand why things are the way that they are. Obviously, he's speaking directly to a group who is living and dying for their faith, and in the midst of that, he is continually commissioning them to live out the gospel, to live out the model and the character of Christ. When I say live out the gospel, I hope we're all on the same page. By that, I mean that we're supposed to look like Jesus looks, you know, and if we were going to have a question or a testimony time, we would have to all admit that not all of us are able to do that on a very regular, or let me rephrase, all of us are not able to do that all the time, right? There's failures, absolutely. There's times where we mess up. But the consistent lifestyle or the choices of our lives should reflect what we heard in 1 John on Sunday and what we've continued to hear in 1 Peter, and that is that our desires have changed. And because of that, people are watching us, and we're supposed to be living out Jesus Christ to them. And they may not understand that at times, and that's okay. It's okay that they don't understand. But we're supposed to live it out because, he said back in chapter 1, this is a great testimony to them. Or I'm sorry, in chapter 2, he said this is a great testimony to them. Remember that in chapter 3, verse 18, a couple weeks ago, you studied how he wrote, "For Christ also suffered once for sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit." So he's talking about how we're supposed to model that for Christ. Just like Christ died, we die, and so on and so forth. In context, in chapter 3, he's telling his readers to suffer so that they may have a proper Christian testimony to the people that are around them. To be like Christ as they suffer for doing good and not to revile those who are pursuing them. And that is the exemplary model of what Jesus did in his own life and death. When we come to chapter 4, things shift a little bit. Here, the Christian testimony is not really in mind, although it may seem like that at first appearance. Our suffering this time, as we come into chapter 4, Peter is going to argue is a part of a bigger picture. So if I was going to back up, I would say it like this. Is when one of the things that they say is the most devastating argument against any religious form, but specifically against Christianity, is what do you do with the problem of evil? What do you do with the problem of pain? And the Christian church has all these responses. And if you're in my Sunday school class, we've talked about them at length at the beginning of this quarter, about how we have the God's eye perspective, and that is that you and I don't always understand what God understands, and therefore he does things that we wouldn't do, that we may picture as evil, or we may picture as painful or suffering, but in reality, from his view, they're a part of a bigger plan, right, that we just don't understand. Maybe it's sickness, maybe you fill in the blank. Then there's the perspective of how God sometimes punishes sin, right? And there's all these answers to what you do with the problem of evil, what you do with the problem of suffering. Peter, to this point, has argued not about how you answer the question, but rather how you respond to it. In other words, I can't give you an answer for why people are killing you. That's what Peter's saying to them. But while they're killing you, here's what you should do. You should model Jesus. When you come to chapter 4, now Peter is going to take up the more philosophical question of why. Why is this happening to you? Why does suffering take place? Why does evil take place? Why are these believers dying because of their commitment to Christ? What are they hurting by being committed to Christ? What is the real problem here? Why are they suffering? Since, he says, therefore Christ suffered in the flesh, arm yourselves with the same way of thinking. That's how he introduces that in chapter 4, verse number 1. In other words, he's saying that just like Christ had to suffer, you need to put that type of mindset in your own life. You need to put that own mindset in you. In other words, I like the terminology that he uses here. For to arm oneself immediately brings to mind the idea of battle. And the battle that he's going to defend here, that you and I are going to take, is an action against the Gentiles. It's an action against what we might expect. And he's saying in this moment, just like Jesus suffered, remember, you are a representative of Christ. Arm yourselves with the same mentality that he took on. The battle that he's going to define is not the Gentiles in specific in the midst of all this suffering, but rather what the Gentiles are doing. This is, okay, let me make it more simple than that. What he's saying in this moment is, we have to deal with the reality that we suffer in the midst of an evil world, and there's two things you're supposed to do. Number one, you're supposed to keep a consistent Christian testimony during that pain, during that suffering, during that evil. And the second thing you're supposed to do is to be intentional about the fact you are going to suffer because Gentiles, or those who are outside of the faith, act completely different than you and I do. And you are to wage war with their actions in the same manner that Christ waged war with them. So he says in that moment that Christians should make ready themselves for the battle, or arm themselves with the mind of Christ. In other words, not only are we now supposed to live like Jesus, but now he's saying, you got to start thinking like Jesus as well. That's the most simple way I can put it. First three chapters are, in the midst of your suffering, you got to live like Jesus. Now in chapter 4 it becomes, now you need to start thinking like Jesus. You need to look at the world through the same lens that he looked at it. By thinking, he does not merely mean a momentary thought, but he's talking about a consistent way of thinking, a consistent mindset. Something that you actually make decisions based on, whether it's voting or where you're going to eat or how you raise your children or what school or education you're going to get. He's saying you need to take on a different way of thinking, a different mindset. Boy, I wish that I could just stop at this moment, not go any further, and just talk the rest of the night about putting on the mind of Christ. We could go, for example, to Philippians 1. There's a great passage about putting on the mind of Christ. We could go to other places, but how different would the church look? Forget the world for a moment. How different would the church look if we began to think like Jesus thinks? And in the church, we focus a lot on acting like Jesus acts, and that's for good reason. There's nothing better than living out the gospel in your actions and having people recognize that and make a life difference, right? Last week we talked about in Mardi Gras, one of the greatest ambitions was going down there and trying to show Jesus in a different perspective than what other people were doing. But what we've done in the midst of that discussion in the church, we've so focused on that, that over the years we've forgotten to say, what's inside here makes a difference too. Because in fact, what's inside here will eventually make its way out, right? So he says, you not only have to act like Jesus, church, but you got to start to think like Jesus. You got to start arming your mind for this battle, for what's in front of you. That's how you deal with immorality. Well, most people think that you deal with immorality by the action themselves, right? You have a, okay, I'll speak as a parent. I have a 4-year-old who apparently did not need to be taught how to lie, right? I mean, he knows how to do it, and he is exceptionally terrible at it, thank goodness, right? But he is very pervasive about it. And dad and mom have to have a unified front about how to deal with this, you know? The first time, it was a little comical. You kind of laugh it off like, okay, because he says after he lies, just kidding, right? You know? One example. The other day, I'm in the kitchen, and he says, hey, mom said I could have chocolate. Well, listen, it's 7:30 in the morning, and mom did not say you could have chocolate. And I said, are you sure about that? Oh, absolutely. She said, you just have to get it for me. And I said, well, in that case, let me get you some, but first I'm going to go ask mom. So all the way from the kitchen back to the bedroom, we have screaming of, I was just kidding, I was just kidding, I was just kidding, I was just kidding, right? You didn't have to teach him how to do that, right? But as a parent, my natural reaction is, come here, kid, let me take care of that hind end of yours for a little while, and I'm gonna correct this. And by the way, you already know that I believe fundamentally in capital punishment with kids, okay? I brought you into the world, I'll take you out of it if necessary. But sometimes as a parent, especially, and I think you see this in the roles of husbands and wives, I'm more about correcting the action and not so much the mind. And mom can at times be more about changing the mind and not correcting the action. That's why God puts us together, right? In the church, we have all of this teaching about correcting the action, but we don't spend as much time dealing with the way people think. And the immorality battle that we wage, not only in the world, in the culture, but the immorality battle we wage is one that is waged in the mind. If you want to stop immorality, you have to change the way people think. I alluded to this in my prayer this evening. One of my favorite pastors, Pastor White, who is a Lutheran Reformed Lutheran pastor, spoke in Washington, D.C. at a pastor's conference I went to about 10 years ago. And he says, at the conference, he says, if Roe v. Wade was overturned today, it would be no more enforceable as the prohibition was a couple of generations ago. Now, he says, somebody's going to tell me that by saying that, I don't care about pro-life legislation. That's not true. Pro-life legislation is necessary. But if you don't change the way people think, if you don't change how they view life, you will never be able to enforce the law. They will go and have alley abortions, backstreet abortions, so on and so forth. They will find ways around the law. You have to change the way they think, right? That's what Peter's about to get to, is in this suffering, it's not enough just to focus on your actions. You've got to begin to engage your mind. You've got to look at the world differently. Immorality is not a hot-button issue in our culture today, and the believer's battle weapon against immorality in his own life and in your own life tonight is having the mind of Christ, to love the things that Jesus loves and to hate the things that Jesus hates. That's the mindset that we're talking about. Here, it gets put in a bigger picture, and this is how it's all coming together. He says, since therefore Christ suffered in the flesh, arm yourselves with the same way of thinking. Listen to this, for whoever has suffered in the flesh ceased from sin. That is not to say in this moment that suffering always leads to purification, or that by some measure of the human condition we are purified by the amount of suffering that it goes to. We have seen religious piety along those lines in the history of the church, and it doesn't work. In fact, Martin Luther, while he was a monk for a brief period, he would go through this suffering, through this period of his life where he would punish his body and go through not only that, but also go into confession something like 15 times a day to deal with his sin before he captured the gospel, which is what made him so passionate about the gospel. And finally, one day his priest in the confessional says to him, Martin, if you don't have anything better to confess, then stop coming in here, right? You know. And there's a mindset in the history of the church that if I could just punish my body, if I could just, you know, even to a physical extreme where we had monks that would beat themselves, leave scars on their back, that somehow they would purify themselves. That's not what Peter's arguing for in this moment. When he says that sin has ceased if we have suffered in the flesh, he's not saying that suffering automatically leads to a sinless life. What he's saying is that there is something about the purification that takes place in suffering. It's what C.S. Lewis would say, and you've heard me quote this many times, that God whispers to us in our pleasure, but he shouts to us in our pain. Oftentimes, it takes difficulty in our life to really get where we're supposed to be. I'm going to say something that always gets me in trouble. I believe that God is willing to be radical in your life to conform you into the image of his Son. Even put you through things that you would not want to go through for the very specific purpose of conforming you, of shaping you into the image of Christ. And I believe that's what Peter's trying to get to in this moment. The one who has gone through this persecution, the one who has been suffering, and he knows it firsthand, he's gone through it, he knows his church is going through it, he's saying, you are being purified. That's why the church has historically expanded during persecution and trial, because guess what happens? Nominal Christianity does not exist in persecution. You're gone, right? You are either in the Father's love or you're not. And if you're not, you're not going to sit around and allow yourself to suffer. You're going to get out of there. And if you are, you're going to become so dependent on the Father and so connected to Christ through prayer, through the Spirit's work in your life, that there is nothing possible except that you come out of that situation completely different. And so he says in this moment that the one who's been through this, who's had that pound of flesh removed, so to speak, he ceases from sin. There's something purifying about this. Here's the distinction between chapter 3 and chapter 4. Whereas suffering was concerned with the Christian testimony in chapter 3 and chapter 4, here he's speaking of the suffering as a part of doing good and the changing of the mind. In other words, when one is walking away from immorality and sin, he is following the mindset of Christ. And likewise, when he's following the mindset of Christ, he's walking away from sin. Therefore, he says he has ceased to sin. Not that sin has altogether been removed, but he has broken the bond that sin has held his life captive from. That is my greatest ambition for every member, every regular attender, every visitor of this church. I recognize that we're all going to make mistakes, and I hope you recognize that I make mistakes, right? That's just part of life. That's a part of the human condition. But my prayer is not that you'll be sinless moving forward, but that the bond of sin is broken in your life. I may not be perfect, but I don't want to do what I used to want. I want to be different. There's a different mindset. Help me out. I know I'm right about this. Of course. I want to be more like Jesus when I'm Jim's age than I am today. I want to be more like Jesus tomorrow than I am today. One quick story. You may get a laugh out of this. Used to be, first started preaching, somebody'd say, you know, one day you're going to make a good preacher, you know. I didn't like that. Then I got my first, you know, full-time pastor position, and they would say, boy, you're going to be a good preacher one day, you know. Then I got my first full-time senior pastor, and people would say, one day you're going to be a good preacher, you know? And every bit of pride in me goes, I already am. Let me tell you. Did you not? I know you were sleeping during the message, but let me give you a Cliff Notes version of what you just missed. Right? Until I had one particular lady that I have all of the respect for in the world, who's the only person that's ever said that to me, to be quite honest with you, since I've been here, say to me, I'm not talking about that. I'm not talking about that. She said, you are going to be a good pastor, good father, good husband, all of those things one day. And I said, well, I hope that I'm trying to do that now. And she said, oh, you're great, but you're going to be better another day down the road. That's my ambition in my personal life. That's what I want for you. That's why grandparents make such good parents. They already screwed their own kids up. They know how to do it the next time around. Right? Now, you can tell your kids that, and you can say it came straight from the pastor. We're supposed to be growing in our walk with Christ and our character with Christ. And as part of that growth, our mind is supposed to be changing. Even when I first committed my life to Christ, there were still things that I wanted to hold on to. But over time, those things, that bond is broken, and you start saying, I don't need that anymore. It's another call for Peter to these people in the midst of dying to holiness. But this time, he doesn't do it by the action or attacking the action. He attacks it by addressing the way you think. Because he understood that the way you think will have a direct ramification on the way you live. Verse 2. Kind of brings us this thought to a conclusion. So he says, so as to live for the rest of the time in the flesh, no longer for human passions, but for the will of God. No matter the amount of time that you and I are given tonight, we're not responsible for determining that. We are to consider our days and walk humbly before God. Psalm 90 in verse 4 says that 1,000 years is but yesterday when it's past. 1,000 years is but yesterday when it's past. Therefore, he says in that same psalm in verse 4, teach us to number our days that we may get a heart of wisdom. Psalm 90, verse 4. 1,000 years is but a yesterday in the past. Therefore, teach us to number our days that we may get a heart of wisdom. Well, there's a life verse for you, right? Yeah. As a young man, you kind of always assume that you'll have this unlimited amount of days. As an old man, you wonder where the days have gone. Right, Jim? You say, how did it pass by so quickly? Time is but a drop. Time is but a drop of water in a bucket, is what the psalmist is getting at. So let us today redeem this moment. And that's what Peter is trying to impress upon these people. Redeem each day to live in holiness before God and to give us a heart of wisdom, which is speaks of the mind. Make us think differently. Verse 3, he says, for the time that is past suffices for doing what the Gentiles want to do, living in sensuality, passions, drunkenness, orgies, drinking, parties, and lawless idolatry. All the time of the past, it was given to the reckless behavior of the unbelievers. We might summarize his words by saying that we have given enough time to the foolishness of the world. We've dedicated enough of our lives to that. Then he defines what those reckless actions of theirs are. So living in sensuality, that doesn't take much description, right? Passions, I think one thing that we have to be careful of is passion can be a great thing when brought unsubdued by the power of the gospel, when redeemed by Christ, but it can also be a very dangerous thing. Drunkenness, orgies, drinking parties, and lawless idolatry. Perhaps the key to these is the phrase directly before them, what the Gentiles want to do. And in Peter's mindset, knowing from history, his mindset here is not to speak of those who are not Jews, but to rather he's speaking of those, he's using that terminology to speak of those who have been unredeemed in Christ. He's saying, in other words, we've given enough of our time to the things that the unredeemed people do. We've paid enough attention to it. In fact, I'm going to go so far as to say the church, by preaching on some things, has given enough attention to these things. And not to our benefit. Go with me really fast. I want you to go to Ephesians real fast. I want to show you a verse. I've talked about this verse before, but ever so quickly, I want to direct you to Ephesians. I believe it's it's chapter 4. Let me double check here. Chapter 4. No, I'm sorry. Chapter 5 and verse number 11 and 12. Listen to this. Paul writes there, "Take no part in unfruitful works of darkness, but instead expose them." And we always capitalize on that. We say, see, we're supposed to stand up there and say, hey, look, you know, this is wrong, this is wrong, this is wrong. All these things are being done. But listen to this. Verse 12. "For it is shameful even to speak of the things that are done, that they do in secret," speaking of what the sinners do. One of the problems I have with some preaching is that we have at times spent too much time talking about the darkness and not enough time talking about the light. We've spent way too much time glorifying sin. We've spoken about things that really didn't need to even be spoken about. And I call it the baseball park effect. You know, it used to be nobody runs across the baseball field in the middle of a game. One person does it, national TV shows it, and guess what? Within a couple of months, 15 more people have tried it, and it just keeps getting worse from there, right? The more sometimes you speak about the darkness, the more you're encouraging the darkness to reign. And what we should do is focus on our hope in Christ. Now, that's not to say that we're to mellow out our stance between what is darkness and what is light. That is to say that sometimes we give way too much credence to what is darkness and not enough credence or not enough proclamation of the light. In verse 3 here of 1 Peter chapter 4, he says, "For the time of the past suffices." It's good enough. It's good enough. That is both a personal statement, I think, and a corporate one. It's good enough. The amount of time that has already been dedicated to the unredeemed acts of the world, it's good enough. Let's not focus on that anymore. Let's focus on moving forward. Let's not get our minds so narrowly focused on all the evil that's out there and what's been done. Let's get our minds focused on something else, right? I was thinking today about recent events surrounding events surrounding our current president when he was during his second inauguration. There was a well-known pastor who was asked to come and to speak at his inauguration. You might remember by the name of Louis Giglio. He was asked to come and give the benediction, the prayer. Later it was realized by a liberal watchdog group that Pastor Giglio, who I have a lot of respect for, had preached a sermon on the sin of homosexuality. There's an article that came out shortly after that was blown way out of proportion, and they asked basically Pastor Giglio if his position had changed or if he had evolved in his thinking on the matter of homosexuality. I was a little disappointed with Louis because I wish he would have just said, absolutely not. What instead he said was, "I find it interesting that I preached one sermon on homosexuality and that's the one you found, you know. In 30 years of ministry, I preached one sermon on it and that's the one you found." He kind of really didn't answer the question, although I know what his answer is because I have all the confidence in the world in Louis Giglio. But my point in bringing that up is, sometimes situations like this get the church all riled up and we focus on that. And Peter says in this moment, the time to dwell on all that has sufficed. It's moved on. Verse number 4. He says, "With respect to this, they are surprised when you do not join them in the same flood of debauchery and they malign you." He says, in fact, not only has it sufficed, but he says, in the world we live in the flood of debauchery we live in, the world looks at us and says, why aren't you more consumed by it? This is in part why I'm deeply personal about this. Sometimes I feel like when we focus at church so much on the darkness and not on the light, what we at times are doing is we're saying we're consumed with the same things the world is consumed. When it would be better to focus on the hope of all those things. Now, does that mean that there's not a time to call things out? Absolutely not. Absolutely not. It's our responsibility, even when our brothers and sisters are in sin, to deal with that. right? To go to them in a spirit of love and unity, a bond of peace, and the Spirit's authority and work, and to have a discussion about that. But I guess what I'm trying to get to is I feel like the church could use these words because we've gone to an opposite extreme. Let me give it to you by way of a personal testimony. I see this especially at youth camp. I go to youth camp anymore, and I don't care if it's some of the best youth camps I've ever been to. Last year I went to a youth camp and preached one night, and I decided that I was going to buy the sermons from the rest of it. It wasn't the one we went to, but it was one that I was asked to go and speak at. So I did. I bought all the sermons because I wanted to hear some of the speakers. One person in particular I wanted to hear. There were seven sermons preached that week. Seven sermons, okay? I preached on Elijah, and I talked about how sometimes we get in the wrong place and his moment in the cave, and how the power of God's whisper has the power to raise us to be warriors. And I went on this great, you know, well, I don't know whether it's great or not, but I went on this long sermon about God's powerful work in Elijah's life through this cave moment when God just simply whispered to him. Okay, that eliminates one of the seven sermons, right? The other six sermons, at some point in every one of them, and two of them very specifically, were all directed towards pornography. Now, listen, pornography is a major problem in our society. We live in a sexually charged world. There's just no ifs, ands, buts about it. And it's not a problem with just our high school young men. It's a problem. I think I've told this story before. I preached a revival 5-6 years ago, and I had an 84-year-old deacon that came up and told me he was hooked to pornography. It's a problem across the board. Problem across the board. Okay? Here's my issue, though, with that. Of those six sermons that talked about the problem of pornography, when they got done, not a one of them talked about the work of Christ on the cross of Calvary. And my issue with that is, you said to them, we want you to be saved from pornography, but you did not tell them how to be saved from it. And sometimes, as pastors, and I think as the church, and I'm going to make the application on your Facebook page, okay? We get on Facebook, and we tell of all the evils in the world, but we do not take the time to tell of the marvelous work of Jesus Christ on the cross of Calvary. I'm going to speak for me personally. I have not put on Facebook, Jesus died as a substitute for my death. For me on the cross of Calvary. His blood paid the penalty on my behalf and appeased the anger of God against me. He was buried, put in a tomb, and he was raised 3 days later to show that he had defeated the stronghold of sin over my life. But I'm a lot quicker to put on there, you know, this is the culture we live in. How about you? The church going through all of the evil in Peter's day that they're going through, especially with the suffering, going through all of those things, would have had a natural tendency, if they had Facebook at the time, to say, look at what all these people are doing. And Peter's response is, you have to change the way you think. And the first thing you got to change about the way you think is you got to stop focusing on what they're doing.
That's right.
That time has sufficed. Do not give any more credence to that. Move on. Talk about the light. Talk about the hope that we have. In a country of diversity, I'm going to go back to my illustration with Louis Giglio. In a country of diversity that is supposed to respect and encourage people who hold different views, how is it that we could be, that the media, that the world could be so angry and so vile towards a preacher of the gospel in Louis Giglio, who had never done anything to them? In fact, a man who had spent countless years and millions of dollars building wells in Africa for folks that didn't have drinking water, who had done countless humanitarian deeds. He worked with George W. Bush to combat AIDS. And they threw all of that away because they disagreed with him on one issue. Peter says, that is the world we live in. They do not understand. If you get on Facebook and you try to convince the world that what they are doing is wrong, they are not going to understand what you are saying. They don't get it. Nor can we expect them to get it until the work of Christ is applied to their life. They're not going to get it. I said this on Sunday. I feel like in some ways I'm re-preaching Sunday morning's message. They don't understand why you would give money. They don't understand why you would give time. They don't understand why you would give talents. Until the precious work of Christ is applied to their life, it seems like utter foolishness to them. And Peter's basic response to this is, don't give it so much time. Sometimes as the church, I'm not getting as far as I wanted to tonight, so I'm just going to cut it off. It'll be all right. Sometimes as the church, we get paralyzed by the sin of the unredeemed. Sometimes we get to a place where we are so consumed by the sin in the world, and likewise, even sometimes we get so consumed with our own sin that we can't take the next logical step forward. And Peter is saying, the time of the past has sufficed. Don't give it another day. You cannot go back here and change it. You cannot change the way they're doing it. The only thing that can change is the way you think about it. I'll confess my own sin. Last night, I turned off the TV at 11:30, and I walked into my wife and I said, I may talk a few politics with people, but I'm going to turn Fox News off in my car. I'm not going to watch it on TV for the next month and a half because it is absolutely tearing up my heart. I am angry when I get done watching. I am angry at politicians. I am angry at people. I am angry at the church. And Peter is saying, that's paralyzing to you. And it is. It is. It is. Absolutely. I mean, it was literally everything I could do for an hour and a half not to post something on Facebook, which I knew would ultimately get me in trouble. I would not have had to finish preparing for tonight because I would have been fired by tonight after everything I wanted to write. The only correlation I make with that is that ultimately, that's what happens oftentimes in a believer's life with sin. We get so consumed. I have a really close friend who fell on some sin, just terrible situation. It messed me up for like 3 months. Because all I could think was, how did that happen? How did he do that? You know? I mean, it consumed me. The time of the past has sufficed, Peter says. Change the way you're thinking about